Welcome to part one of this four-part series on energy, equity, health, and solutions in relation to climate change. This series is part of the American Humanist Association's Center for Education Here for Climate Environmental Response effort. This session will be recorded to air on hereforclimate.org and American Humanist Center for Education.org. I am Kristen Wintermute, Director of the Center for Education, and I'm pleased to be hosting this evening's event. I will now turn over to Caroline Peters, who was key in arranging tonight's session. Caroline?
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome, and thanks for joining us tonight. My name is Caroline Peters, and I am the Here for Climate intern with the American Humanist Association. We've been working on this series for a few months now, so I'm really excited to be with you all here tonight in the first part of our series. Just a few logistics before I introduce our speaker for the evening. After Dr. Chief's presentation, there will be time for a Q&A. The Q&A function is available at the bottom of your screen in the control panel. I know for some that the chat is more comfortable and familiar, so if you would like to use the chat, we were also keeping an eye on that. If you would like to use subtitles, you can also access the subtitle function in the control panel at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Now I'm very honored and excited to introduce our speaker for the evening, Dr. Karletta Chief. Dr. Chief is an associate professor and extension specialist in the Department of Environmental Science at the University of Arizona. The goal of her research is to improve our understanding, tools, and predictions of watershed hydrology, unsaturated flow in arid environments, and how natural and human disturbances affect soil hydrology through the use of physically based methods. Dr. Chief's research also focuses on how Indigenous communities will be affected by climate change and collaborated in an interdisciplinary group of scientists, including hydrologists, system dynamic modelers, and social scientists, to determine how hydrological models can be improved to identify and mitigate risks to these vulnerable populations. As an extension specialist, she works to bring relevant science to Native American communities in a culturally sensitive manner by providing hydrology expertise, transferring knowledge, and assessing information needs and developing applied science projects. Dr. Chief is a member of a national network of Indigenous and non-Indigenous scientists focusing on climate change impacts to Indigenous peoples and has co-authored several publications in the special issue of Climactic Change entitled Climate Change and Indigenous Peoples in the United States, Impacts, Experiences, and Actions, and Forest Conservation in the Anthropocene. Dr. Chief is also a member of the Rising Voices and Climate and Traditional Knowledges Workgroup with a focus on climate impacts to tribal waters. She co-authored a tribes chapter in the Southwest Climate Assessment Report and Provisional Guidelines for Considering Traditional Knowledges in Climate Change Initiatives. Two of her primary tribal projects are the Pyramid Lake Paiute Tribe Climate Adaptation and Traditional Knowledge and the Navajo Nation Gold King Mine Spill Impacts. Dr. Chief supervises and advises the research of 11 students, 10 of which are Native American, working on topics related to tribal environmental issues. Dr. Chief is Diné, originally from Black Mesa, Arizona, and received a bachelor's in science and master's in science in civil and environmental engineering from Stanford University in 1998 and 2000. She received her PhD in hydrology and water resources in the School of Engineering at the University of Arizona in 2007. She completed her postdoctorate at Desert Research Institute in the Division of Hydrologic Sciences in Las Vegas, Nevada, where she worked on large weighing lysimeters at the scaling environmental processes in heterogeneous arid soils project in Boulder City. In 2011, Dr. Chief was named American Indian Science and Engineering Society Most Promising Scientist / Scholar. 2013 Stanford University Distinguished Alumni Scholar, 2015 Native American 40 Under 40, 2016 American Indian Science and Engineering Professional of the Year, 2016 Phoenix Indian Center Woman of the Year, American Geophysical Union Ambassador. We are very honored to have you here tonight, and I will now hand it over to Dr. Karletta Chief.
Thank you, Caroline, and thank you to all of those that have joined this evening. I'm very honored to be invited to speak tonight. And before we start, I want to acknowledge that the place where I work at the University of Arizona is on the Indigenous homelands of the Tohono O'odham and Pascal Yaqui people. So I want to express my gratitude for allowing us to be guests here in Southern Arizona. I also want to acknowledge my own relations. I am Bitterwater, born for Near the Water people. My maternal grandfather is Mini Goats and my paternal grandfather's Red Running into the Water. This is how I identify myself as a Diné woman. Tonight I'll be talking about a program that we have at the University of Arizona where we are working on solutions for food, energy, and water challenges that are faced by Indigenous communities in a way that involves the community in the co-design of these solutions. This program that we have is called Indigenous Food, Energy, Water Security, and Sovereignty. And the vision of this program is to train our graduate students to have intercultural awareness, to have a food, energy, water expertise in water and agricultural technologies to secure water and food sovereignty and contribute to a more diverse workforce. Currently, we have 26 trainees, nearly 40% of them are Native American, and they span a wide range of interdisciplinary engineering and science and social science fields. The goal of our program is to provide a unique on-site research and training opportunity for our graduate students that bridges across engineering, social, and physical sciences. And the foundation of their training is to have this social integration where they're not only getting expertise in engineering and science, but also getting training in the social sciences, particularly in the American Indian Studies, where they have an opportunity to get education in Indigenous governance, culture, and society. And with that foundation, building up to the basic fundamentals of the discipline that they are pursuing, and also combining that with a interdisciplinary training that would allow them to also get the fundamentals in instrumentation and sensors and materials across the food, energy, water nexus. And then we bring our students to the communities where they're immersed and apply their training and to work in co-design with the community. And it's centered around an off-grid solar nanofiltration water treatment system. And this provides opportunity for our graduate students to learn how to teach and provide training for tribal college students as well as tribal members. So the objectives of our training program is that the students will be able to have a transdisciplinary training that allows them to co-solve solutions with the society in which they're working with. In addition, we provide a number of professional development courses and workshops to improve the communication skills of our students so that they can better train and do education at tribal colleges or with tribal professionals. And then to train our students how to work in Indigenous communities and also through our program, supporting the pathways of tribal college students who may be interested in food, energy, water systems. And then finally, to develop community-run and maintained water and agricultural systems that are owned and operated by the community. So the way that we do this is that we integrate a number of different disciplines across the engineering and sciences. This includes material science, hydrology, control of environmental agriculture, energy, and combining that together with the unit and system concepts so that the student will not only understand the depth of their own discipline, but also be able to step back and see the challenge that the communities face from a systems perspective. Secondly, the graduate students have the opportunity to improve their science communication and their teaching skills by teaching at the tribal colleges and university and the tribal workshops. The graduate students have an opportunity to be hands-on, to not have to wait until they graduate to do this type of work, but really get into the community on the ground and work collaboratively with the Indigenous communities. Our primary partner in IndigiFuse is Diné College. Diné College is the oldest tribal college in the United States and is on the Navajo Nation. The Navajo Nation is the largest tribe in the United States and has the largest land base in the United States. The land base of the Navajo Nation is equivalent to the state of West Virginia. At Diné College, there's a land grant office, and Benita Litson directs that land grant office. The mission of the land grant office is to work with the community to empower them with knowledge and strengthen them in various skills. So I represent a big team, and so I want to credit them for all the amazing work that they have done in addition to our community partners and our students. And so this is an illustration of all our faculty across the various fields that are the core of this program. In addition to these faculty, we also have extended faculty that work with the graduate trainees in their research. So each of the graduate trainees are assigned to one of the core faculty across these disciplines of environmental science, chemical engineering, all the way to electrical computer engineering, as well as in education. So even though these students are assigned to each of these core faculty, they also may have a primary advisor outside of the core faculty. The research theme of our training program is the development of novel and sustainable solutions for off-grid production of safe drinking water, brine management operations, and control of environmental agricultural systems. For many Indigenous communities across the United States, approximately 9% do not have access to adequate and clean water supplies, as well as waste disposal systems. On the Navajo Nation, 35% of the Navajo people do not have access to clean water. And this is because of the widely dispersed homes across the Navajo Nation and the fact that they are not connected to central energy, power and water systems like most cities are. And this calls for more innovative solutions that will allow a remote Navajo citizen or an Indigenous citizen to have access to clean water. My team has been working on this for many years, and this has evolved into various iterations of this off-grid water treatment system. And the cost of water of a nearby town on the Navajo Nation is approximately 40 cents per 100 gallon. Many of the people that do not have access to running water in their homes have to haul water. And this means that they would travel anywhere from 10 to 50 miles one way to get to a community water source. And when they get there, they would fill their water barrels or their cisterns with water and take that back home to where they live in these remote communities. And so as a result, they're paying for gas, they're paying for food, as each trip is quite long. And so the cost for that tends to be much, much higher, about $13.30 per 100 gallons. And so this is an enormous cost for many citizens that have limited resources. So in addressing this challenge of lack of access to clean water, we have developed several different water treatment systems. And the lead for this has been Dr. Bob Arnold and Dr. Vicky Caranacola. And so I want to encourage you to go visit their websites. And so the design that was initially developed on the Navajo Nation in Loup, Arizona, was using a solar membrane distillation system. And this system reduced the cost of the water to $5.60 per 100 gallon. As we began to work with the tribal college and the Navajo communities, we were able to design a more mobile system that sits on the back of a trailer that allows the water system to be moved where it is needed. And this new system reduces the cost to 20 cents per 100 gallon. This is a view of the system. It sits on a trailer bed. There is a raw water tank on the left side and the finished water tank on the right side. This system is powered by solar panels. And so these solar panels can be pushed up at the appropriate positioning, and it powers all the electrical control systems and the pumps that run the water through these pre-filters and membranes. And this system has a DC pump that you can't see, as well as a battery that stores the solar energy. This system, the idea is that we could use the brine that's produced from the treatment as a way to irrigate and to be able to not only get clean water, but to provide a source for agricultural production. And so that allows it to be more of a closed system and allows the water to be used for other purposes, in addition to potable sources. We are also designing a system, redesigning. It's always an iterative process, such that this system could be downscaled to more household scale, because currently the system we have is providing water for more than one family. And that the solar system could also provide excess energy to power other electronics, such as computers and lights that are needed. This system is currently at Diné College in Salley, Arizona. And we've been able to do the training with the tribal college students. In terms of the food, production, what we are trying to do is work with our control environmental agricultural systems to look at how OPVs, organic photovoltaics, could be used as part of the greenhouse, not only to power the system within the greenhouse, the sensors and controls, but also be a way to be flexible on the actual structure of the greenhouse itself, so that it's more integrated. This research is led by Becca Waller and Dr. Barat Casero. So our educational pedagogy in training our students, which is very unique from students that are typically going into engineering and sciences where they're very focused within their fields, our educational pedagogy is that the students have an interdisciplinary training that involves co-learning with their peers as well as with the communities that they work in, as well as having a systems thinking where they're not looking, you know, in their own little bubble within a small view, but taking a step back and understanding the challenge that is faced from a more holistic perspective. The training components that the graduate students have is that they pursue their major courses like all students do, as well as their research, but their research will be more focused on food, energy, water systems. They'll have an opportunity to do an internship, and that could be in industry, could be with the community or nonprofit. They will complete a Indigifuse minor, which includes the, not only the food, energy, water disciplines, but a course in American Indian Studies. They have ongoing professional development and cultural immersion that involves teaching at the tribal college, and then centered around a pilot project, which is the off-grid solar nanofiltration unit. We found that the immersion within the community was really profound for the students. The students spent their spring break in the Navajo community, first going to the capital of the Navajo Nation and meeting with the Navajo elected leaders, going into the tribal council chambers and understanding how a tribal government functions, as well as learning about tribal sovereignty. Then they go to visit with the environmental professionals in the tribe that have to manage the water and the land. Then the students go to the tribal college and understand how a tribal college system works, meet tribal college students, learn how to interact with them, and begin to train and do some teaching. And then they go to a community where they stay at with a local family where they stay in a hogan, which is a traditional dwelling of the Navajo people, which is completely off-grid. And so they experience what it means to live without access, immediate access to food, energy, and water. And during that time, they are participating in storytelling, training from cultural experts and medicine people, where they get to understand a little bit about what the Navajo worldview is. Then they go into the community and learn about the other challenges, such as uranium mining and other legacy mining, and how that has impacted people. They also go to the local chapter houses and meet elders and work with them to learn how to do local gardening. The Indigifuse PhD minor allows the students to not only understand, you know, the engineering and science and the systems aspect of food, energy, water, but they also have an opportunity to take a course in American Indian
Studies.
It's
5:30.
And they have several options within the American Indian Studies that they could take. And this allows them to get more of a structured training in American Indian Studies. We have a weekly seminar series that we have the students take, and they come to class and they get trained in a variety of different aspects, including professional development, writing, how to interact with Indigenous communities, what decolonization of food, energy, water systems mean, and engage in a dialogue with each other. In addition, we've because of the pandemic and our inability to do some of this training and traveling in person, we've been able to modify the community engagement by doing more of a virtual engagement where, for example, last semester, the students interviewed our community partners and wrote up a community profile. In this picture, what you see is the solar nanofiltration unit that is powered by solar panels with a raw water tank and the polished water tank. And this is a photo of one of our graduate students, Christopher Yazzi, who is Navajo, pursuing a PhD in chemical and environmental engineering. One of our board members, Walter Phelps, who is from the Navajo Nation and a former tribal leader doing a lot of work with the communities, and myself. I also want to invite everyone out there listening tonight to join in our Native Voices in STEM. This seminar series is a seminar series that corresponds with the training that our students engage in, but also involves many people on and off campus. And our first seminar speaker is gonna be next Wednesday by Emma Robbins, who is from Dig Deep. And Dig Deep is a nonprofit on the Navajo Nation that is providing water to the Navajo people and has done quite a lot during this pandemic. And so I encourage you to visit our website and join us for our seminar series. And so we've had an excellent opportunity to invite many people with expertise in working with Indigenous communities in all varieties of fields within the food, energy, water systems. This provides an opportunity for our graduate students to get an understanding of all the various ways that many people engage with Indigenous communities and really engage in a dialogue of what it means to work with Indigenous communities. Our Native Voices in STEM has really taken off last semester, especially with the pandemic and opportunities to be able to join from wherever you are. So we've had great attendance from people across the United States. We have developed a course called Chemical and Environmental Engineering 514, Sustainable Water Supplies for Remote Communities. And this course is taught by Dr. Byron Hempel. And in this course, our graduate students come together with other graduate students in all different fields, from engineering and science to the social sciences, to talk about what it means to co-design and provide solutions in food, energy, water systems for remote communities. And we held this class for the first time last year, and the students do a capstone project where they design a system for a particular remote Indigenous communities. And the projects that the students came up with were amazing. They were able to have an opportunity to work in an interdisciplinary team and really build upon each other's strengths. So I'm really excited for this semester coming up. I want to share some of the examples of what the students presented. This project presentation was from a team, a multidisciplinary team, and they named it Hard Rocks, Tough People. And for example, in this team, they centered all the food, energy, water concepts within the Navajo worldview. And this diagram shows the Navajo worldview with the sun, the land, the food, and the energy within the cyclical diagram that not only explains food, energy, water, but also the life ways of the Navajo people. And these terms within the food, energy, water systems are all written in the Navajo language. So this is Shundin, which means sun, Toh E'ina, which means water is life, and Nahasan, which is land. And so this is a way that the food, energy, water system is communicated within the existing worldview of the Navajo people. They developed a project pamphlet that integrated the science along with the Navajo language. And for example, they explained what is Indigenous food, energy, water systems and security, what it means to have a greenhouse, and the importance of culture and sovereignty. And so they present a teaching greenhouse in this project. And what it looks like is the teaching greenhouse is designed like a hogan, which is the Navajo traditional home. And it is powered by solar, has a battery storage, has the water treatment system, water storage, and the treatment system. And so this teaching greenhouse would be within a school system where the Navajo kids would be able to learn about food, energy, water systems that is set within their own worldview of a Navajo hogan. So although this would be a greenhouse, it looks like a Navajo hogan, and all the places of the food production and the water treatment will be placed within what is typical and appropriate for a Navajo hogan. Many of our graduate students are role models for other Navajo high school students. And this is how we're able to support the pathways of Native young students who want to go into higher education. For example, Chris Yazzie, who's a product of the Tribal College and Universities, and also Manuelito Chief, who is from the Navajo Nation as well, pursuing graduate degrees in food, energy, water systems, mentored Navajo students at the high schools on their science projects. And so it was a really wonderful opportunity for them to mentor. We also engage in a wide variety of outreach activities to share our project and just be, you know, just share all the wonderful things that our students do. And one way is this 2020 STEM for All video showcase. And in this video, we get to share the stories of our students. And in this one is Nikki Tooley, who's an amazing young Navajo graduate student who talks about her journey and her passion to go into food, energy, water systems and to work in this area of how we can work together to address food, energy, water insecurities in Indigenous communities. We also provide training for tribal colleges and university. And so Diné College comes down to the University of Arizona, and they spend about a week at the University of Arizona attending these various intensive workshops. And in these pictures, the tribal college staff are attending a hydroponics crop production. So they have, you know, various types of workshops like on tomatoes and lettuce. And so they really get a chance to really get some continuing education in greenhouses. We also go to Diné College and we go there for a week, and we have an opportunity to do food, energy, water training at Diné College, and also provide interactive activities where the students can also learn in a different way instead of just a lecture. So for example, the learning modules focused on food, energy, water have an instructional guide, a PowerPoint lecture, and then a hands-on activity and assessment tool. These learning modules are available to the tribal college faculty where they can integrate that into other courses. They can pick and choose what aspects they would like to use in their existing courses. So for example, in this tribal college summer training that we do for 1 week, we do learning modules on food, energy, and water. So for example, on food, it's an introduction to greenhouses. And so the students learn about the basics of what a greenhouse is, what the sensors are, its applications around the world, its design constraints and its advantages, and the variables that need to be monitored and controlled to make the greenhouse really productive. So not only do we do the lecture, but then we do hands-on activity with the tribal college students. This is what on energy solar desalinization, where the students learn about water treatment technology and learn about water quality parameters. So our graduate students lead these training activities. So Chris Yazzie is here doing a lecture to about 25 tribal college students. And then they do hands-on activity to see how the water treatment pump works and how the treatment technology works visually, looking to see, you know, at the turbidity differences in the water before and after treatment. And then finally is the water aspect. So many of the students are familiar with the water challenges that they face in their own communities. So we like to also ensure that our training is place-based so that they understand and learn about what are the water challenges in their own community, how can they participate in sampling and data collection and the basics of watershed hydrology. This video shows a water source in the community that is basically a spring, and it's developed, it's just a pipe coming out and people come up and fill their water at the site. This is what it looks like when we're doing the hands-on training with the tribal college students. And what we want to do is not only, you know, work with the communities to co-design these food, energy, water technologies, but also train the tribal college students in these fields so that they can be encouraged to pursue careers in these food, energy, water, and come back to their own community and contribute to that workforce. So in these pictures, the tribal college students are participating in planting in the greenhouse and setting up irrigation systems. So once we spend 4 days training the tribal college students in these food, energy, water learning modules, they have an opportunity to train their community and showcase what they have learned throughout the week. So this slide shows the tribal college students presenting to their own community members about what they have learned. So in this event, the tribal college students talk about the water treatment system, how it works. They talk about the solar panel and how it works. They talk about the greenhouse system and how it works. And many of these students are learning their language, the Navajo language. And we had several of these tribal college presenters present in the Navajo language. And that in itself is amazing because many of these terms are quite challenging to say. And so it takes a level of fluency in the Navajo language to also communicate science and engineering in the Navajo language. At the end of the training, all of these students receive a certificate stating that they have taken this training, and we encourage them to add it to their resume. With the COVID-19 pandemic that is currently occurring, it has really disproportionately impacted Indigenous communities and has amplified food, energy, water insecurities. The CDC guideline to wash your hands for 20 seconds with soap and water is no easy task for Navajo people that do not have easy access to running water. And as a result of this, it has put strain on the Navajo people and has amplified these impacts. In addition, because of the pandemic, there is amplified food insecurities. And so many of the people do not have access to food in short proximity. Many of them have to travel as well. There's only 13 grocery stores across the Navajo Nation with a travel distance that they have to go. And also many of them go off the Navajo Nation to get their food. So the Navajo Nation has implemented 57-hour curfews on the weekends and evening curfews during the weekdays. And this really limits Navajos to get their food. And so the Navajo Nation has been doing food drives to help with these food insecurities. Our team was able to respond to the COVID-19 on the Navajo Nation by donating 900 pounds of produce to the Navajo Nation in April 2020. And so it was really rewarding to the students here to be able to contribute in a meaningful way. Our program's vision is to be sustainable, and the sustainability is connected to the long-term development of Navajo technicians and professionals that can contribute to the workforce that will be able to have the skills to address food, energy, water insecurities in Indigenous communities. Our education training materials will be widely available to not only the tribal college that we're working with, but other tribal communities and other tribal colleges and universities. We also support the pathway of tribal college students to the university to pursue their education. And we hope that these off-grid water solutions that are being developed with the greenhouse systems would demonstrate other, be a demonstration for other communities to be able to replicate in their communities for those that are in remote areas. So we're meeting a critical need, not only that we are working to meet the need of a food, energy, water workforce, but also that we're meeting the need at a variety of levels, at the tribal, local, state, and international levels, that we're developing a workforce that has intercultural awareness, that has experience working within Indigenous communities, that has these transdisciplinary, interdisciplinary food, energy, water skills, but also knowing that their training in these communities are not just applicable for Indigenous communities, but for developing communities around the world. More recently, we've been able to participate in collaborations with the Navajo Nation, building upon our four-year partnership with Diné College on these off-grid systems to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic. And through the funding of the Agnes Nelms Howery Program in Environment and Social Justice, we were able to get funding to develop two more solar nanofiltration systems that will be piloted at the chapter house. And through another second grant, we were able to collaborate with universities in the region that have decades of experience working with the Navajo Nation so that we can collectively come together to bring our data together and to be able to provide this data to the Navajo decision makers in having to make decisions related to response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share with you a little bit about our project. And I would love to have a discussion further with you right now to really answer your questions and, you know, maybe talk a little bit more about our COVID-19 collaborations with the Navajo Nation. Thank you.
So we have a couple of questions that already came in the chat. One was first a comment and then a question. What a great program design. Do you anticipate implementing a technology transfer to other areas of Indigenous peoples, say to San Diego, which in places has a similar ecological setting? What, I'll leave that question. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. For our particular program, we are focusing a lot of our efforts with the Navajo Nation. And in working with Indigenous communities, it takes a lot of community building, partnership building, building the trust, and ensuring that the communities are involved from the very beginning, all the way to, you know, completion of the project and ensuring that they have these systems that are owned by the community and operated and maintained by the community. And we hope that through our project that this will be replicated with other communities and that it'll be widely available through the manuals and the various tools that we would develop. And we hope that we would like to share that for other people that would like to use it with other communities that would need it. And of course, our program itself is not the answer for every community, but we hope that it's an example for others to use in other communities as well.
Carolyn?
Yes, we have another question that says, or asked, do you have connections with non-Indigenous high schools across the country that may have environmental justice, water resource, Indigenous courses, or other related topics? Are you open to interested high schools contacting you or another appropriate person? I should add that my educational organization has Rock Point High School as a member.
Okay, great. Yes, we are always finding opportunities to work with K-12 students. And that's part of our community engagement. We have these opportunities available for our team, especially for our students, to do that community engagement. And yes, you can contact me or our program coordinator to get more connected.
Can you describe how these sustainable water procedures are being applied to regenerative agriculture?
Okay, right now we are not doing regenerative agriculture. What we are doing is that we are focusing on the greenhouses, the hoop houses. We originally had wanted to focus on controlled environmental agricultural systems, but we know that many of the Navajo communities are using these hoop houses. So we've combine the two so that that we can build upon the hoop houses with these controlled environment agricultural systems. We are interested in regenerative agriculture. That's something that the Navajo people already do within their traditional agricultural practices. And our team has been exploring ways that we could work on regenerative agricultural systems. And we hope to do this with our team and with other collaborative opportunities, like with the University of New Mexico. We just recently had some brainstorming with them, as well as submitting a proposal with them that will look at regenerative agricultural system as a sustainable trajectory towards linking rural and urban communities. And so one of the first things that we would do if this project was funded was to do an assessment with tribal communities to assess what kind of regenerative agricultural practices they are engaging in, and is there a need to look into other types of regenerative agricultural practices that other non-tribal partners are using.
Thank you. I have one other question, and then if other people have questions, please type them in the Q&A or in the chat if you're more comfortable with the chat, and we're happy to ask them and get answers. The next question I have is, have you installed subsurface drip irrigation in vegetable field crops improve crop water use efficiency? To improve, I think there was a typo in there.
Okay, so my collaborator and co-PI is Dr. Marat Casera, who has a wealth of knowledge and depth in various types of greenhouses and controlled environmental agriculture production. So I couldn't say specifically what types of subsurface irrigation systems he's using, but for our project with the Navajo Nation, we're primarily looking at greenhouses, and most of those irrigation systems are surficial, as they're not, in soil outside in the field, but rather in these greenhouses, and they're often soilless.
It looks like there's one more question. It says, please inform us on the history and current state of the groundwater and the nature of its salinity.
For the Navajo Nation, the Navajo communities primarily depend on groundwater systems because there's not a lot of surface sources. And these community water systems that Navajo citizens go to haul water are dependent on groundwater systems. Some of these systems are penetrating unconfined aquifers, which means these are alluvial aquifers that are more vulnerable to climate change impacts and droughts. And so when the groundwater table falls below the pump, then that becomes a problem. And many of these alluvial systems are primarily for livestock. However, even though they are non-potable sources, many of the Navajo people do use it for drinking water, for drinking and for domestic purposes. The groundwater sources vary across the Navajo Nation, but what I can say is that for the northern area of the Navajo Nation, the primary groundwater there is the Navajo aquifer, which has high quality water quality. For the southern portion of the Navajo Nation, it is the Coconino aquifer, which often tends to have higher total dissolved solids and higher salinity. For the Eastern and more Northeastern Navajo Nation area, I am not familiar with the groundwater sources. And so I couldn't say too
it's
much
six
about
o'clock.
Those other groundwater sources.
So kind of off of that, I have a question. So you said the groundwater that you're drawing from, based on the aquifer that it's in, it's more susceptible to climate change and drought. So I'm wondering if your like projects, how they adapt to that?
I didn't get your question. You broke up. Can you repeat that, please?
Oh, yes, sorry. When you were answering that question, the previous question, you said that the aquifers are more susceptible to climate change and drought since they're permeable. And I was wondering, with your projects, how are they adapting for droughts and climate change?
So for our project, what we're doing is we're developing these off-grid water treatment systems that are connected to greenhouse systems as a way to have a more resilient solution with climate change impacts, because climate change will amplify food insecurities, and also with water changes in water quality. When you have a drought, your water quality tends to decrease, increasing salinity, increasing total dissolved solids. So this provides a water treatment option that could help with increasing water quality. In terms of the water supply and water availability, that is a much different challenge that really relates to water supply and water deeper water access, which involves groundwater drilling for maybe deeper groundwater sources, or finding opportunities to store water supply that can be longer and can be of much larger source. So I think your question is an excellent one, but I think there are so many aspects of that related to you know, communities trying to provide ways that they can have more water access and more storage for the longer term when you have these droughts and climate change.
Thank you. Another question is, do you know of anyone in a parallel position in Nebraska or South Dakota that is helping with the water concerns of the Oglala Sioux?
Unfortunately, I do not know of anybody in the region who may be working in a similar area, but I'm sure there are. I do know of a professor at Arizona State University who is Lakota. Her name is Dr. Utakue Conroy Ben, and she her discipline is chemical and environmental engineering. And what she is working on is working with tribal communities to look at water quality challenges, particularly with relation to emerging contaminants. And she's somebody to look up. She was just featured in a Nature article that is talking about water and water quality challenges in tribal communities. So please look her up. Thank you so much. And also, I do want to mention that our program, IndigiFuse, is recruiting graduate students for cohort 4, and our application deadline is February 28th. And so please see our website to apply if you're a graduate student out there who wants to be in this training program.
Thank you so much. This has been such an informative and wonderful session with you. I appreciate you being with us, Caroline.
Thank you again. It was awesome. Thank you for sharing your knowledge and for being with us here tonight. Thank you everyone for your participation in tonight's event. You can find more information and details about Here for Climate at hereforclimate.org.